To the Okinawan Women's Peace Caravan that took place in 1996 and came to the United States, including the Bay Area, but several cities across the United States. And out of that event, as they were on this peace caravan that was protesting the rape of a 12-year-old girl in Okinawa, that kind of kicked off the push for the closure of Futenma Base, which is still being contested. As the U.S. military tries to relocate Futenma to this beautiful location on your postcard in Hinoko. So as long as they've been working on fighting against that closure, we as Women for Genuine Security have been in the United States working with them, staying in dialogue with them as students, teachers, mothers, writers, and organizers concerned with genuine security in our communities and the wider world. I'd like to share with you just briefly our vision for genuine security as opposed to military security. A genuine security is a world based on justice and respect for others, free of militarism, violence, and all forms of sexual exploitation. We work for the safety, well-being, and long-term sustainability of all of our communities. I want to we have a film that's for sale on the registration table, Living Along the Fence Line, which lifts up the stories of seven women and their struggles to live next door to a U.S. military base from seven different locations around the world, and it's also in several different languages. So that's part of the work that we've done. I want to just acknowledge my colleagues here who are part of Women for Genuine Security and have been a part of it from the beginning also, Margot Okazare and Yoko and Eriko, also there who helped to put together this event. We're also here on behalf of the Bay Area Stop the Pacific Pivot, which many other organizations in the Bay Area are part of, like Asian Americans for Peace and Justice Coalition, Veterans for Peace, Chapter 69, Code Pink, Bayan USA, and others who have come together to educate and inform and to stop the further expansion of U.S. militarization in the Asia-Pacific region. So I want to thank specifically those two organizations for tonight and also Veterans for Peace. We'd like to invite up our guests who've come the longest way, who've come from Okinawa, to be with us tonight. And I think one of the representatives, Doug will be coming up to share and give us a very important update about the ever-shifting and increasingly more intense situation in Okinawa. So Doug, would you like to come up and, Doug, thanks, come on up.
Hello everybody, I'm Doug Lummis. I've been living in Okinawa 16 years. I'm pretty tired after the convention. I hope I don't pass out in the middle of this. I'm working against a very severe timekeeper. I have 10 minutes. What in the hell can I say in 10 minutes? A little bit. It's very convenient that everybody has this postcard, okay? As she said, 1995, there was a terrible gang rape, ugly gang rape incident that got everybody so angry that the U.S. and Japan thought they had to do something to calm people down, and they said, okay, we'll take Futenma Marine Air Station out of the middle of the town where it is stuck, called famously the most dangerous airstrip in the world, but we'll move it to here. Take a look at your postcard if you have it there. The new Hinoko base, you see the peninsula, and behind the peninsula is Camp Schwab. That's already a Marine base. The sea out there is Oura Bay, O-U-R-A, I think is the way it's spelled, and it is a pristine crystal, the tip of the peninsula, and then sticking out into the bay in both directions. 3,500,000 truckloads of dirt are to be dumped into the bay, which they assure us will not affect the environment. And people are supposed to believe that. Eduardo, how many years, 24 hours a day?
9 years of dumpsters, 24 hours, 7 days a week.
But it won't hurt the environment, don't worry. Okay, that's a little background. As for an update, in April, I apologize to the people who heard my talk 2 days ago. I'm going to repeat myself. At the beginning of April, Admiral Harry Harris, who is the commander of Pacific, U.S. Forces Pacific, he's the big top in the Pacific, testified at the Senate Armed Services Committee for a couple of days. You can see it on YouTube. And at one point he was asked, okay, what's going on with the base at Henoko? How's the construction going? And he said with great irritation, it's 2 years behind. And he gave two reasons. One is that the city office had the mayor of the city of Nago, in which this is located, is anti-base and refuses to cooperate. There are a number of roads, open fields, lots, rivers that are under city authority, mayor's authority, and he will not allow them to use them as building yards. The trucks cannot go down them. They cannot go in there. And that's fouled up their plans considerably. And the second reason Admiral Harry Harris gave was to sit in at the gate. Which slows down the trucks. Some days they can't get trucks in, and some days they can get a few in, but they cannot go in and out of the gate, through the gate, in the way that they would like to. Now, the 2 years behind is utter nonsense, of course, because it took them something like 10 years to come up with a schedule on which they could become 2 years behind. Okay? So they're way, way, way behind. He said that with great irritation, which means this is very interesting, because it means that the U.S. is very unhappy with this. It also means that the Congress is worried about construction at Henoko. Congress doesn't usually concern itself with specific construction projects, but they're very worried about this one, worried enough that they would ask him in the congressional hearing what's going on over there. And he told them with great irritation. But the next interesting thing is that the following day, the chief cabinet secretary of the Japanese cabinet, Suga, had a press conference in which he said, oh no, that's not true, we're right on schedule. Which means that the U.S. has learned that it cannot believe or trust the information it gets from the Japanese government, because they have their own sources of information. The U.S. military is there watching us outside the gate and taking pictures and movies, and they know my name and a whole lot of other people's names. They've got very good intelligence, and they know that it's 2 years or much more behind. So either the chief cabinet secretary is lying to the U.S. government, or he really doesn't know, and we don't know which. Okay. A couple of days after that, in front of the gate, that is in your postcard in the back, there's a road that goes through, and there's several gates into the base, and that's where the sit-in is, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for years now. On that day, there was a music festival. It happened to be Sanshin Day. Sanshin is the Okinawan three-stringed instrument, and people were singing and dancing and having a good time, as they often do out there. And one of the Diet members, National Diet members who was there, picked up the microphone and said, "I have a very serious announcement to make." And everybody became quiet and thought, uh-oh, going to be bad news. And he said, "The government has accepted the out-of-court settlement." Now, let me explain that as much as I can in the...
One minute.
1 minute, okay. In 1 minute. The government was suing the Okinawa governor. The Okinawa governor was suing back, and the judge suggested an out-of-court settlement. Drop both suits, negotiate, and in the meantime, the government must stop construction until the thing is settled. So the government agreed. They choked that down. They stopped construction. You may have seen pictures of this bay with floats strung together and a sea battle between kayaks and... I've just got to take one more minute. I'm sorry.
Good time is up.
The floats are gone. The sea battle is not going on. Construction is not proceeding. We don't know how long that will last, but that's how it is now. And I've got lots more to tell you, but I can't. Thank you. Members of Okinawa, VFP Okinawa delegation, please stand up.
Yay.
So everybody can see you. Thank you, folks.
Thank you, Doug, and thank you for all the VFP members from Okinawa for coming, and coming tonight, too, at the end of the long conference. I know that there are some materials in the back, and someone is going to just give a one-minute orientation to the materials that are available for us.
No, I just want to announce that I brought this pamphlet, U.S. Military Base Issues in Okinawa, which was made by Okinawa Prefecture Government. I brought 170 copies, so please take free and print back and share this information with your folks. And also, actually, the data they gave, government gave us data, and we printed. Cost a lot of money, but I don't want to take them back home. So thanks. And one copy of 5 minutes of anti-nuclear, new base resistance, Okinawa, 5 minutes. So I will give you to Debbie.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Yeah, let's pass those around. If he doesn't want to take them back, and I think we all would love to see more data. So I want to bring Gwen Kirk up now, who's going to share with us a little bit about why we put on this event this evening, where the what our questions are, and the impetus for our dialogue tonight and our ongoing research on this issue.
Hi, Yeah. Somebody probably has it on us. Well, thank you so much, everybody. Yes, that's exactly what I'm looking for. You can have it back, but I'd just like to mention it. Thanks so much, everyone, for coming. Piggybacking on what was said about the situation in Okinawa, many of you may have heard a big delegation who came from Okinawa last November to the Bay Area first and then to Washington, D.C. And prior to that, the City Council in Berkeley passed a resolution in support of the protesters. We first met Edo Heinrich Sanchez a year ago when he came to thank some council members. First of all, the resolution went through the Peace and Justice Commission and then came to the full council. Since then, Cambridge passed a resolution. There's one pending in Seattle, and there's another one pending in Honolulu. There may be others pending. I think it's something that Veterans for Peace were interested in doing. I heard Ed saying that you wanted to do something in Colorado. So this is kind of a little strategy of having more people in the States, you know, express their support for the protesters and against this expansion of bases. Women for Genuine Security also put out a little solidarity statement in support of Okinawan protesters. Quite a number of organizations have already signed on to it. If your organization didn't sign on to it or you think you might be interested in it, we would love to have more signatories to this, and then we'll, you know, send it back to folks in Okinawa and also use it as part of the argument for more cities in the United States to take up this issue. So now my little part of the program is to talk a tiny bit about why we wanted to do this session tonight, focusing on U.S.-China relations. Women for Genuine Security is part of a small international network that has members from Okinawa, mainland Japan, South Korea, the Philippines, Guam, Hawaii, continental U.S., and actually also Puerto Rico. We've been meeting from time to time. Some of you here, especially Women's International League, helped support our international gathering in 2007 here in the Bay Area for the network. And in each of those locations, people are dealing with the ramping up of militarism, new bases, new agreements. Whether it's Jeju in South Korea, it's Hanako in Okinawa, the new ETCA agreement in the Philippines, doing more base conversion in the Philippines, the Marianas, Hagan Island, taking more land in Hawaii, and so on and so forth. And everyone is being told that this is because of the rise of China. So you've got to agree with this, and you know, and so on. Quote, because, and we're putting the rise of China in quotes, right? And so we began to think more and more that we need to understand U.S.-China relations. And just what you might know in terms of general knowledge, this is a kind of complicated and contradictory situation. I'm looking for my paper here because I had a few notes that I don't think I'll remember the whole list. So we know that there's huge economic interdependence. Almost everything we buy is made in China. China holds part of the U.S. national debt. It was part of RIMPAC, the military exercises based in Hawaii, both in 2014 and again this year. But nevertheless, the media is constantly telling us about the rise of China, and there seems to be an assumption that China is going to become an empire in the same way that European powers were empires in the 19th century and the United States, you know, has been an empire. So that's something which we want to explore and question. We're wondering, what does this mean for smaller countries like Vietnam and the Philippines, who are kind of sandwiched in between the United States and China? How is this linked to the remilitarization of Japan? The comfort women's struggle that was going on here in the city you know, is really picking up on the remilitarization of Japan, the contesting of history from World War II and so on.
Clearly there's a continuing arms race. The U.S. now has put in Aegis missiles in South Korea, THAAD missiles in South Korea, and so on. And this is an area with nuclear powers. Russia, China, and the U.S. all have nuclear weapons in this region.
Korea.
Oh, good. I'm in good shape.
Nobody's exempt.
So those are some of the questions that kind of this all raised for us. And this sort of complexity and contradictory story is not the one we are reading in the mainstream press, right? We're just reading Rise of China, have to oppose them. We know that U.S. involvement in the Asia-Pacific region is nothing new. The different women's groups we're working with, you know, go back in history to sort of tell the story from their perspective. So in some cases, it starts in 1893 with the annexation of Hawaii, 1898, the U.S. War against Spain, which added Guam and the Philippines, you know, to U.S. territories, and the beginning of sort of U.S. empire overseas. The Pacific War, of course, led to bases in Okinawa, mainland Japan, the home porting of the 7th Fleet in Japan, ultimately the division of Korea and the Korean War, etc., to the present day. So we are very excited to have the opportunity this evening to hear from Anne Wright, former colonel in the U.S. Army and also a former diplomat, who many of you will know, gave up those positions in protest against the U.S. attack on Iraq, and has since dedicated her life to supporting many different peace organizations and struggles. Anne will talk a little bit about her perspective on U.S.-China relations, and she'll be followed by K.J. No, who introduced himself earlier as a journalist and a political correspondent for Flashpoint on KPFA. I want to ask a sort of housekeeping question just before I pass the mic to Anne, and that is, are there people in the room who don't know that they do not want to be photographed or who should not be photographed for any reason? Can people who are taking photographs identify themselves? So there's, thank you very much. Gina's at the back there with a video. Okay, good. We just want to be sensitive to, you know, photography and so on, so we'll, you know, take that issue up. So I think that's my thing wrapping up now. Really thanking you very much for coming and hoping that this conversation will help us to figure out more effective activism, more cohesive kind of strategies. It's marvelous to see so many organizations represented here and thinking about how we can be a more of a, you know, cohesive force against the Pacific pivot and the military buildup, and also for the idea of less adversarial relations with China, who is one of the United States' greatest trading partners, and someone who we really need a good relationship with around climate change and a whole range of, you know, challenges that face us. So thank you so much. Thank you. Anne.
All right.
Thank you so much, Gwen. As Gwen said, I am a long-term U.S. government employee. I was with the U.S. military for 29 years, 16 on active duty, and 13 on active duty, 16 in the reserves. I retired as a colonel. I was also a U.S. diplomat for 16 years and served in U.S. embassies in Nicaragua, Grenada, Somalia, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, Sierra Leone, Micronesia. I helped reopen the U.S. embassy in Kabul, Afghanistan in December of 2001. Then I went on to what became my final assignment, which was the deputy ambassador for the United States in Mongolia. I never served in China. I was in Mongolia, and that's pretty close by. But it was in 2003 that I ended up resigning from the U.S. government in opposition to the war in Iraq. And since then, I have been honored. I've been honored to work with groups that have been stalwarts in challenging our U.S. government policies around the world. Having been a part of the problem for so long, working with the government, now I'm using my voice and my background in the U.S. Embassy to help or the U.S. government to interpret things that are happening in a very different lens. A lens that I think we as citizens really need to use to be very observant, watchful, and critical about what any administration in the United States is doing. Because really, when you look at it, they're not too much different. They're not too much different. Now, the title that I've got here, we're talking about U.S.-China relations, but let's put it in a bigger perspective. What's going on right now? Why is the United States all of a sudden pivoting, using the phrase of Hillary Clinton as Secretary of State? Her great policy thing was, let's have a pivot to Asia, and that was after the United States had spent a decade and a half making sure that everything was a great success in the Middle East. Is that right? Yeah. Everything was so successful, now we can leave the Middle East and let's go cause chaos in Asia. And that's really what this pivot is all about. If you look, and I'm going to go kind of the background of what the U.S. is doing all over to put in perspective, you know, what's happening and why China is kind of being demonized right now. If you look, could China and Russia have put their countries so close to our bases? It's like the recognition that the United States is pretty active in putting its bases wherever it wants to. And we have some 800 military bases around the world now, which is lower than the 1,400 military bases we had around the world during the Cold War. Many, many of them in Germany and Italy and the UK. And we still have them there, but it's been much reduced there. But not so much in Asia. In the 800 bases we have around the world, that we still have the most in Germany, 174 in Germany. We have 113 military bases in Japan, and 79% of those bases in Japan are located where?
Okinawa.
And that's why this delegation from Okinawa is here right now. The people of Okinawa are tired of being the brunt, taking the brunt of all of the U.S. military bases in Japan. The other place where the majority of U.S. bases are, the third largest number of U.S. bases in the world, are in Korea. 83 military bases are in Korea. Now, let's just think about it. Okay, the United States, this picture right here, the U.S. has, and this is just the tip of the iceberg, really, when you put dots where every one of those military bases are, it really... I mean, the whole world is littered with them. Let's go on to the next one. And this kind of shows us a little bit more of the numbers of the bases that we have. Not only are the in Asia and the Pacific there, besides just Japan and South Korea, we've got them, of course, in the occupied territory, the occupied country of, where I live, Hawaii. Now, a state of the United States, annexed by the United States, but we have large military bases in Hawaii. We've got in the Marshall Islands, the Kwajalein Missile Test Range, which is the far end of the Ronald Reagan Missile Test Facility, which starts out right here in California, in Vandenberg Air Base, where we send intercontinental ballistic missiles, which may give a little bit of heartburn to China, seeing missiles heading in their direction. And when you think of another Asian country, only 5 minutes left? I thought I was supposed to get 15.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry. too enthusiastic.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
She's good. So we have the missile test range in Kwajalein. There are two military bases in a place that we then kicked us out 25 years ago in the Philippines, but the U.S. is coming back to the Philippines. And then on the territory of Guam, we have three major military bases. There are two U.S. military installations in Australia, one a Marine base of 2,500 Marines that are now going to be permanently assigned in Australia, plus the largest national security agency listening station in the world is located in Australia, and it's called Pine Gap. Next one. Gwen mentioned one of the major issues that we have now, U.S. military exercises in Asia. And one of them, the largest naval exercise in the history of the world, was just held in July and early August off the waters of Hawaii and off Southern California, and it's called the Rim of the Pacific, Rim Pack Naval Exercises. Let's go on to the next one. 26 nations were involved in this, 45 ships, 5 submarines, 2,200 aircraft, 2,500 personnel, 25,000 personnel. And let's go to the next one. And what countries were they? Look at all of these. And interestingly enough, you know, the U.S. is going after China in so many ways. China is our enemy. China is the one that's building the runways on the disputed islands, which is a problem. There's no doubt about that on the international legal scene between the dispute between Vietnam, the Philippines, China, on who actually should be able to have access to those islands. And China has put its foot in the middle of it to build runways on and build up these coral atolls. And the U.S. and the international community has been telling China not to do this, not to do this. But guess who gets invited to the RIMPAC military exercises? Yeah. So we're kind of speaking out of both sides of our mouth on what we are looking at with China. We, as Gwen also said, the Chinese own our debt. If they would call in the debt that they have purchased for the United States, we would be bankrupt as a country. If China would stop those endless numbers of ships carrying thousands of containers filled with goods that are made in China, that clothe us, that are the computers that we use, that are the this and the that, we would be in really major trouble because we no longer produce these things. So it is really crazy in a way, all of this demonization that's going on in China right now. Let's go to the next one. Just to add a little bit more of putting pressure in that part of the world, what is the United States doing in another hotspot? A hotspot that's right next to China, and one of China's, I wouldn't say allies, but probably the country that has the only working relationship of a sort with North Korea. China is the interlocutor of North Korea. And I think in many ways, whenever the United States wants to send a message diplomatically behind the scenes, it will probably be the Chinese that are carrying that message. And so what are we doing in that relationship? Right now the United States has just finished up, again, a land exercise, the largest land exercise we've had in Asia, over 300,000 people in China, including the 28,000 U.S. military that are permanently assigned there, plus the South Korean military, in an exercise called Wright on the DMZ. You know, the U.S. military comes up with some really strange terms for its military exercises. And if you want to set a government on edge, when you call the military exercise decapitation, that is exactly what we have called this one. And no wonder the North Koreans are antsy about what's happened. And no wonder they may have an atomic weapon, nuclear bombs that they set off, because they say that is our defense against you, the United States, invading and occupying us. And when we start doing these types of things, with military exercises like that, no wonder. And also the THAAD missile deployment that has now happened in South Korea, all of this setting persons on edge, to include the Chinese, of course, which are complaining bitterly that the U.S. missile defense system has another operational facility right there in South Korea, just hundreds of miles from the south, from the Chinese border, in the next one. And in Japan, the Chinese are concerned. When the United States, over the last two presidential administrations, have been saying to the government of Japan, particularly the Abe government, you need to dump that stupid Article 9, that no war part of your constitution, because we, the United States, need some help on these wars that we're prosecuting. We need for you to be a part of us. And so many people in Japan, millions, hundreds of millions of people of Japan, saying, no, we don't want to be a part of the U.S. wars, that none of our young kids, none of our young boys and girls have been coming home in the body bags from Vietnam, from Panama, from Grenada, from Somalia, from Iraq, from Afghanistan. So the citizen opposition to what the U.S. is trying to get the Japanese government to do is very strong. And then you talk, we've talked about in Okinawa the large numbers of military bases and more construction in these bases. I should mention also in for South Korea, the Chinese are very concerned about the new naval base that is now completed construction on Jeju Island, that is a part of a strategic link through that area, a place where U.S. Aegis missile destroyers will be placed, and Aegis missiles, which are part of the U.S. missile defense system, that are on South Korean destroyers that will be there. All of that is very upsetting to the Chinese. Let's go to the next one. I mentioned in Australia the military buildup there by the United States. And that's a good one, yeah. And so with that, I want to say that for when we talk about China and we interpret to perhaps provoke to get a response from China that they can use, that our government can use, or our government and its great supporters, the military-industrial complex, no matter whether it's the Republicans in power or the Democrats in power, it's these big, big corporations that make a killing out of killing. They make in millions and billions of dollars because of the buildups that we have to challenge, in our government's words, to challenge the growth of China. I mean, you look at China, and I'll just end on this. Let's put in perspective what China really is, landmass-wise. China's a heck of a lot bigger than the United States, isn't it? I mean, it is a big, big country. It's got four times more people than we do. It has 1,300,000,000 people. 1,300,000,000. How many does the United States have? 313 million. So they've got to have a huge country to house all those. But when you look at it, it's not. The square miles, square kilometers of land mass, China is only a slightly bit bigger than the United States. And yet we think, my God, it's big, it's big, it's terrible. It's wow. You look at the military budget, I mean, we're scared to death of China. I mean, that's why we're devoting all this energy, isn't it? Well, what are the budgets like? What are the budgets like? The United States spends four times more on its military budget than China does. And let's look at the military equipment, aircraft carriers, why the Chinese must be going all over the world. And I've got a timekeeper here that is telling me the time is up. And you just tell me how many aircraft carriers China has.
Three.
No, that's not right.
One.
How many does the United States have? 10. We have 10. And I will just end on just going through a couple of other things. How many nuclear weapons does China have? We probably don't know, but maybe a couple of hundred. How many do we have? 1,700? I mean, not that it takes all of those to kill everybody on the planet, but the nuclear program, very different. How about strategic bombers? We have 143, and China on strategic bombers has zero.
Why are we
scared of this? Strategic nuclear submarines, how many do they have? Four. How many do we have? 15. Yeah. And if you go through, just look at the military setup, China is not a threat to the United States. They do have more people out of their 1.3 billion people. This is the last one. 1.3 billion people, so at least half of them must be in the military. I mean, because they are the threat. No, from 1.3 billion people, they have 2,300,000. We have only 300 million people, and we have 1.5 million. So proportionally, we have a heck of a lot more people that are part of our military, and not even counting the National Guard and Reserve. So I would say China is not a threat to us. Thank you.
Two parts to our audience engagement. The first part is we'd like to invite clarifying questions.
Yes.
Questions or something that maybe they touched on briefly you'd like them to expand on. So just questions. And then we'll have a 15-minute period time of questions. And after that, we're going to have a more dialogue time, more interactive dialogue time about what can we do to counter the adversarial relationship that's being promoted with China. What can we do on action steps? But first of all, just questions. And just to remind you that a good question does not need to be a long question. In fact, good questions are short questions. So, yes, so if you could say your name, and maybe we'll just hear like three at a time. We'll hear three of them, and then we'll hear three more after the time for answers. So go ahead.
I would like some suggestions about resources, where to find research or information about this subject to continue to become more knowledgeable. So if you have a specific think tank.
Go to get information. There are some very interesting things that the CIA puts out. The CIA fact book that has specific facts on every country in the world. And to my knowledge, it's not politically tainted yet. It actually is a real fact book. The other thing, if you want more information about the specifics on the militaries, like the military comparisons, if you go to Jane's Military something or other, website. It's called Jane's. It is J-A-N-E-S. It is the authoritative military resource book in the world.
Let's take a couple of people that had their hands up at the beginning here. Okay, we'll take three more questions here.
Sort of a bundle question, Ann. What did Denmark, France, and Germany have to do with the Pacific Rim, and about how much do these exercises cost, and who, is there anybody in Congress like a Proxmire that sort of questions the expenses about these exercises and the need for them?
So a question about the military exercises, joint military exercises. So here and then here. Go ahead.
My name's Russell, and this is for Ann. Can you give us some comparison of military expenditure per capita? Because I did something a couple years ago. For the U.S., it's a couple hundred dollars per person or more. And in China, it's like maybe $2. Of course, there's four times more people. But that you may have better figures.
Thank you, Russ.
Yes.
And our third question.
Thank you. Yes, no. There's an election taking place in November, and I think that both the Democrats, Democrats and Republicans, have both put forward a very strong populist anti-China program. So that pretty much, you know, the trade restrictions that both the Democrats and Trump are calling for, these target Chinese workers as taking away American jobs. China is the reason, they say, why wages have fallen and jobs are at scarce in the United States. And these are really, that the plan really is to have protectionist measures that increase the cost of goods from China. Then the capitalists in the U.S. who manufacture goods will make higher profits and they'll be able to hire more workers. What's wrong with that picture? You'll make more money. Yeah.
Do you have a specific question?
Yeah, so I just think that, you know, how do we, what are we going to do in terms of this threat to peace caused by the U.S. and this recent targeting of China?
So maybe specifically on trade, there's some trade questions there.
So on the two questions for me, what are the countries of like France and Denmark and the European countries doing? Well, it's Hawaii. They want to have a little vacation. I mean, countries do compete to try to get an invitation to this. They really do. And the U.S. says, well, we want to continue our cooperation with our allies all over the world, and we want to have the French, the Danes, the whomever, see how we coordinate with other countries in Asia and the Pacific on this particular type of thing. You know, the U.S. does have military exercises, naval exercises in the North Sea, in the Atlantic, in the Mediterranean, in the South Atlantic, but it's a very interesting thing that those particular countries got an invitation, and I'm sure it was... it wasn't necessarily for purely military operational reasons they got it. And then your question on the cost per capita of the defense budgets, you know, I never had really thought about quite that. And it's true. I mean, it's probably, as you said, like for a family in China, they're probably paying like, 10 cents for their military budget per family, where we are paying a heck of a lot more. Where, by some estimates, 55% of the entire budget of the United States is in some way related to our national military strategy. But that's another thing that I'm going to put in my comparisons of the U.S. and China. Thank you for bringing it up. Thank you.
I'll address very quickly.
Demonization of China. I mean, if you look at the demonization of Russia also, the U.S. and NATO are doing exactly the same things to us about what the threats coming from Russia. In fact, several of us were on a trip to Russia, a 17-day trip. Jan and David Hartzell were on that trip, and anybody else in the audience on it. And we went specifically to come back to be able to talk to you all about what Russian people have to say about what the West is calling them. And whether or not do they want war, do they want their government to prosecute a war against the West? And of course the answer is no, they don't. They don't want it. And they're wondering why in the world are you doing this to us? Why are you demonizing us? We haven't done anything to you. Yeah, we may have a government you don't like, but we don't like your government either. And the same for the Chinese. I mean, how many of you all have been to China in the last 5 years or so? Yeah, and how many of you all, what would you say the tourist population in the United States is right now of Chinese tourists in the U.S.? I mean, there are tons. Chinese international students in our university are the top number of people we have as international students in our country. And they're all wondering, what in the world is going on? What have we done to you? What has happened here? And yet the political elite and the military elite of our country are demonizing two major powers of our country to scare the bejesus out of us, to make sure that we don't argue with them about how much money we give to their corporations that ensure that they are elected. So we've got to push back against this, because both Russia and China, I mean, they're wondering what's going on, and they have their own elites in their country, their military elites and political elites, who say we're sovereign countries. We can't let the United States and or NATO push us around like this. So we've got to kind of push back a little bit. And so you see both China and Russia flexing their muscles. But they're not, in my opinion, they're not starting this. It's us that's starting this. And we have got to, as citizens, we've got to hold accountable our officials. We've got to write letters to the editors. We've got to make sure that we contact our congressmen and women to say, what's going on here? Why are you allowing this to happen? And we've got to sign petitions. I mean, the White House has to respond when they get a petition that has over 100,000 signatures They have to respond to it. And there are lots of petitions they're getting these days where people are concerned about so many things. But the media is a key part of this, that the media, as it is kind of the handmaiden of whatever administration's in power. And whether it's Fox that's helping the Republicans or CNN that's helping the Democrats, we are getting tainted news about what's going on in the world. So it's critical that we support groups like Pacifica, KFPA, KPFA, KABCDDEFG, Democracy Now, got my little Democracy Now, and alternative sources of news, because our commercial media is selling us down the river.
We're going to invite all of you to think about that question, about what we can do. But first, I want to just make sure, are there other clarifying questions or expansions? So, yes. Sherman. And also, and David. So these three.
Okay, so thanks. So there are groups in the Philippines who are against, I guess, like, the U.S. Thinking of the Philippines as a pun. So, like the Philippines is becoming, just like another country to turn against China. You know, and so, like, one of the ways in which that manifests itself is in, groups like NAFCON, for instance, who are against military aid to the Philippines coming from the U.S. But I'm wondering about like other countries in the region too. You know, so like, are there like forces in China who are against like building the airstrip in the middle of the South China Sea? And are there like forces in Vietnam who are opposed to Vietnam's participation in the TPP?
Thank you. We'll listen to all three questions.
I was wondering if there's a network of groups in all the congregation it would be both for their mutual support, but also we ought to be supporting them.
This will probably turn out to be a very ignorant question, but I always thought that military exercises on the sea were carried out, structured on the assumption of a hypothetical enemy. If China was participating in RIMPAC, who was the hypothetical enemy?
Well, it's an excellent question, and there was a lot of argument about whether or not China would be invited to this year's RIMPAC. It was invited for the very first time 4 years ago when tensions were not very high. And apparently the invitation went out 2 years ago for them to go into this RIMPAC. And there was a great, great argument within the U.S. government about whether or not they should rescind that invitation. And I was kind of surprised that it wasn't rescinded. Where the Chinese ship was and how much it was a real part of those military exercises, I honestly don't know. But I almost can guarantee you they didn't allow the Chinese ship to come into Pearl Harbor. Because most of the ships at some time or another got to come into Pearl Harbor, have some liberty leave in Honolulu and Waikiki. But I guarantee you that Chinese ship didn't get in. And there's another ship that doesn't get into Pearl Harbor. You know, the U.S. has a long, long memory. And if you cross the U.S., like, being so bold and audacious that you tell the United States, that your country tells the United States that you will not let U.S. military naval vessels into your country because the U.S. will not tell you whether or not there are nuclear weapons on board, similar to what New Zealand did, 30 years ago. Well, the little New Zealand ship that participates in RIMPAC does not get to go into Pearl Harbor. But as we found when we went out to protest, when we were protesting RIMPAC a couple of years ago, and we found a military ship in the Honolulu commercial harbor, you know, right in the tourist part of the harbor, and it was like, oh man, this is a gift. Here is a military thing. We can go right up to it with our signs. We can have everything taken, you know. And so we were there getting our pictures taken of stop, rim, pack, no more, whatever. And some of the sailors came off of it, and they came over and said, "What? Why are you protesting us?" And we said, well, you're a part of RIMPAC. You're taking part of those exercises. And they said, yeah, but look where we are. Your military won't even let us into Pearl Harbor. We're from New Zealand, you know. And we love it out here. We don't want to go to Pearl Harbor. I'll just answer one more part. About a network of people in all of these countries that are concerned and are willing to speak out. Well, in places like China and Vietnam, I think it's very difficult for people to speak out that way. And I haven't heard of anyone that we can work with, although we certainly need to keep our ears to the ground on this. But there is an informal network. In fact, I was in Guantanamo, Cuba, and Arlo, you were there, weren't you, for the Guantanamo conference? The Guantanamo, Cuba, there's an organization called the Abolition of Foreign Military Bases. And now, why would the Cubans want to have this in Guantanamo, Cuba? Oh, yeah. Right. The oldest U.S. military base in the world is in Guantanamo, 112 years that we have held that base. Well, we had representatives from, I think it was, 20 countries that were there. We had over 250 participants, and the Cubans are going to have this conference again in November of 2017, and they want to have more Americans to be coming to this too, as well as people from all over the world. But it was really quite an excellent conference. There has been another conference that was held in Ecuador about 6 years ago on foreign military bases. And that was because the U.S. at that time had a U.S. base in Ecuador, and the Ecuadorians wanted it out of there. So there is an informal network of people around the world that are concerned about this. Another organization that works on this is Bruce Gagnon and the Global Network Against Weapons in Space, Nuclear Weapons in Space. And they do a very good job of contacting groups that have U.S. military bases in particular. I want to be a little bit shameless about this next thing. You were so kind to mention the quote from one of the Chinese leaders about the Palestinians and the issue of helping oppressed peoples around the world. Well, I'm part of a mission that is going to be going in September, and since this is sponsored, this night is one of the sponsors, is the Women for Genuine Security. I wanted to make sure that all of you all know that there is another women's initiative, and this is called the Women's Vote to Gaza. And we will be sailing. We will be sailing at least one boat and perhaps two boats in September to Gaza to challenge the Israeli illegal naval blockade of Gaza. And this beautiful T-shirt we have available, and if you would like to help us in our fundraising efforts, which are ongoing because we really would like to have a second boat, if you would like to purchase one of these while I'm here, we do have some that are available. Thank you very much.
I don't know if you've visited China, but if you visit...